copy of themselves. So that includes me, Sue. Carol is a wonderful person who I bonded with over things like creativity, honoring individuals, unique bodies, unique personalities, and really just valuing different people for who they are, and honoring our art forms within fiber as well. So I would like you all to join me in welcoming Carol.
Thank you so much. It is an honor to be here. I'm going to be bopping back and forth, so I can next slide. So a dress form is something that you use as a tool when you're making clothing or costumes, something for a human body, and you want to see what it looks like on a real human. The ones that you get in the store, even the fancy ones that dial in and out, actually don't start anatomically correct. So they work. I'll show you what it looks like on size 6 ideal human. But maybe there are cases where you might want to have something that looks like you, that is adjusted to your own particular size. And that's where the magic of DittoForm comes in. We work with real people to make a copy of their bodies, a Ditto copy. So there you can see the standard ones, even the fancy ones, don't really quite work. Over the years, people have done different things. Right. So from plaster cast to the duct tape model on the right. You guys heard of this, duct tape models? it's an interesting experience. You have to trust the person you're working with because you were literally duct taped in and then they cut you out. So wire mesh, you know, padding up and around, all these things have existed for a time. If you've ever had the pleasure of seeing the Dior exhibit that travels around, the beginning part has this long panoramic view of his atelier from above, and you see all the people at work there, and back behind him is a shelf that has all these different bodies on it because they were in France, but they sold to Americans, so they had bodies of their high-end clients, so that they could fit it to them. So we start with a digital image, and then we do magic and translate it into you. So originally we started with the system that's on the left up there. It's used in fitness centers. This particular brand is called Steiku, there's Fit3D. You stand on a platform and a Microsoft Kinect captures your image and then the magic of the software gives you the image. Now we use a handheld device that's far more accurate. It wasn't designed for people, but it does work extremely well for people because we have a lot of geometry or shape and also color, which in 3D world is called texture. So because we have both of those, this device works extremely well. So in a nutshell, what we do is take that image and then carve you out of foam. And I have two little bits of the foam here. I'll pass around. It's 2 inches thick, polyethylene. You can carve it with a kitchen knife and scrape it. That's carved with a CNC router. And so it's a 3-axis, so tabletop, and then it carves from above little puzzle pieces. We put you together, put a cover on you, stick in a box, and mail you to your home. So. So I didn't come up with this idea. The co-founders, Mary and Allison. Allison was the person who was the true seamstress who said, was teaching classes. And she knew all these other different techniques, the duct tapes, that you didn't need to do a lot of that stuff. But she figured there had to be a way to get from 3D image to back to a 3D model. And she just wondered why, of course, like the rest of us, why nobody had done it. And the reason is because it's hard. Because humans, we move, even when we're standing still, we move. And the technology just wasn't quite ready enough until those fitness center things really started being popular, 2015. So she had met up with the Steiku owners, and they were both beta testing, both the DittoForm company and the Steiku company, so they did a trade. And so she agreed to be in their beta tests of how to accurately document a human and vice versa. So it worked out really well.
as happens in a small business, the first couple of years were really hard, and they really, Allison was really motivated by helping people. She wanted people who had trouble fitting themselves to have a tool that would be helpful. And so she wanted to make it accessible, DittoForm for everyone. And unfortunately, when they did their pricing, she didn't factor in her own labor into the cost of the thing. And she also had a separate business, so the overhead of that business just stayed over there. So this new company that developed didn't have overhead or labor built into it. So then when they got lots of orders and hired me, then they were suddenly throwing money out the window right and left. And then we had to get our own production facility. At any rate, end of 2017, Mary and Allison were done. And I said, I want to move to Michigan. Let me take this with. And they said, oh, we don't need another partner. We don't want to keep doing this. And they said, if you want to pay our debt, you can have the company. And so I said, okay. and so I moved home. And my sister was in Detroit, Michigan. That was home for her at the time. So I moved in with her. She had a huge house. One of those investment properties you hear about in Detroit. And so this was the basement. It was a ballroom when it was built in 1925. There's just out of frame is a huge fireplace that has guava tile, if you know, for tile, it's over there. And then there was like a little place where the musicians sat to play. And the back entrance, right, because it's 25, right? So to get into this ballroom space. Anyways, and then I lived in the servants' quarters. Anyway, she sold that house. She flipped it and sold it for a lot of money. And that was at the end of 2019. So we went our separate ways. I got my own place, got a little shop. It's going to be a great year in 2020. I had big dreams. And the universe said, Carol does not know how to run a business. So we're just going to put the world on pause. So you can blame me for the pandemic because I needed to learn a lot. And so that actually worked out well for me so I could do all these things. The couple of things that I did right where I got skilled contractors to do the things I don't know how to do. So I found Brian. Cool story about how I found him because when I moved from Washington, D.C. area where we started to Detroit, I had done what you do. I found my college network and I found a mill worker in the Detroit area that was going to help me out with this. But I got there and then she didn't want to do it because it was fall and it was going to be too much. I didn't have a mill worker. So I was like, oh, okay. So I scrolled on Instagram, CNC router, right? And Brian was loading a new machine into his shop on his Instagram. And I said, where's Brian? And he was 2 miles from my house. So I drove over and said, Brian, you want to do this? He's like, yeah, I got a new machine I got to put to work. So he's been my mill worker ever since. He's done a lot of things. What he's working on the left there is the Rocket Mortgage Classic, which is a PGA thing. He made the trophies for it, so it's really super cool video. He does all this. He like opens up the doors and the floors. Yeah, and he's cool. And so he's made a lot of changes because that foam that we cut is, we slice it vertically, the image digitally, and then slice it this way. We tried it this way, but there's too much potential for the tolerance issues. We get too many slices this way. Sarah does what I call the magic. Her last name is Hull, which is not the same as mine. Mine has an S on the end and only one L. It's very confusing to people. But so she's lovely, and she still lives in Washington, D.C. So when I capture the image, I send it to her, and she does all the editing. Talk about that a little bit more. We use MeshMixer for that. The other thing I do is I joined every single business association I can think of in Michigan. It really helped. And I gave pitches right and left about the business because I was seriously deer in headlights. I had never even thought of myself as an entrepreneur. I like being the person behind the person, doing the stuff, not actually the one out there. So I did all kinds of things. The one on the far right, I was in Boston. If you ever go to Boston, go to the Artisans Asylum. Super cool place. It's a lot like here. So. And then I realized that I needed to do advertising, which is one thing the original owners didn't do. So print magazines still is my best way to reach sewists, because y'all in the room that are sewists, you know, you read that Threads magazine and Sew News and Classic Sewing. You still read them in the print, because you gotta
feel it. And then I'm not a seamstress myself. I am a seamstress, I'm not an expert seamstress. And so I have partnered with people who know how to do the costuming, who know how to do the knitting, who know how to do the alterations and fittings. And they use a digital form. And they don't say, here's the digital form. They say, here's how you alter. And then people are like, wait, what's that? And they're like, it's my body, it's amazing. And that works much better than me trying to learn how to do any of those things. So before the pandemic, I was going to shows, to expos, and I'd get a hotel room nearby. This is something that you don't necessarily want to do in a room because we want to get your exact shape. We don't want to take a shape of you with clothing on. We need your shape. So it's a very personal experience. And we use foundation garments for modesty and also gravity situations. And so, but we get capture shape. So I get a hotel room, but when the pandemic kind of shut everything down, there were no shows going on. And so I thought, oh well, I guess that was the end of DittoForm. But then people kept calling and saying, no, please come. We're stuck in our home. We really, really want this. We're not going on vacation, so we have the money. Come. So I figured out how to get there. And at that time, I was still using that platform system with the tower, and so I couldn't fly with it anyways. So I just drove around in my little Jeep. So yeah. I got my Jeep in the end of 2018, and it currently, and this year I didn't do a lot of driving, it currently has 125,000 miles on it. So I put a lot of miles on those first couple years. So the plan for the future is to figure out how to get more places easier, because that's my pain point in business terms, is how to get the original images. Because even though this technology is starting to be everywhere, people don't know how to do people. It's a different experience. When they do, they don't quite get what I need. Because even the apps on your iPhone, you can get a 3D image of yourself now, today, on your iPhone. But it's going to do things in the cloud and in the magic part to make you symmetrical. It's going to aggregate data. It's going to have a person of a certain age and height and weight and geographical location and gender, and it's going to aggregate that information. So if you're 36, 24, 36, it's going to assume certain other things, including height, right? So same problem as the other things. So I have to figure out how to get to all these places. And then this is in the basement. That was pretty funny. I've done a few celebrities. The show Grace and Frankie with Jane Fonda and Lily Tomlin. During the pandemic, somebody else scanned them, and it scanned them. But I did make Jane Fonda's body, and I'm sure she's got a tiny waist. This was the costume designer. Other uses for the digital form, for those of you who do sewing, you know, trying to figure out what way that pattern goes. This jacket here, trying to figure out where to put the shoulders, all that. Fashion. Historical reenactment works really well with a ditto form. We scan you wearing the corset, and so it's nice and hard. So you don't have to like take off the dress, take off the corset, sit down, fix the dress, put the corset back on, put the dress back on. So it's just easier. And it can hold the weight of all these things. People have done lots of really cool things. That's what this last bit is. One, the wings there are made out of, they're 3D printed, so they're made out of the composite material. They're not super heavy, but they're kind of hanging out there. So she made this pocket, and she was able to use her diddle form to figure out how to weave it. That's going to play. Let's see if I can get this to play. There we go. Spot, he's a miracle worker. He's going to be making something with a bendable foam, that warbler stack, the moldable foam. And so he makes a duct tape thing that he pulls off and makes it into a pattern. He's one of my best friends. So when you have your own body and you're trying to figure out how to adjust something that's from the back, you can't see it unless you look over like this or something. It never quite works, but now you can see. And even though it's not exactly the same, because it's foam and cold and you're warm and human, you can see where the different issues are. You know, it's the same issues. Lots of different types of sewing. Reconstruct something. This one's self-drafted, so she used her diddle book to do all the things. Super talented. So our whole philosophy is built on the idea that nobody is standard, and therefore nobody is right or wrong. So I try not to use judgment words about you're bigger or smaller or wider or taller. Even if it's flattering, because it's just not bigger than what, smaller than what. So, and if somebody asks me what my definition of fit is, my definition of if that clothes, if that shirt fits, if you're comfortable in it. because it might look good, and it might be the right proportions, but if you can't move, it doesn't fit. I like the little laugh a lot. It makes me laugh because I want to make a copy of you. So that's the DittoForm itself, and then I can show you a little bit more about the technology. So put this other one on for the effect of my next video. The simulation. A little more authenticity.
I'm just curious. Yes. CNC these foam pieces, did somebody use them all together?
I glued them together.
What's felt around?
It's a jersey material.
Okay.
It's a lycra. We found that anything that has a natural blend of fibers is actually sticky. So when you put something like this on top of it, it sticks to each other. Like when you put a t-shirt over a t-shirt, right? It has a little struggle. And if you notice that when I put this on her, she doesn't shimmy. She doesn't put her arms in and do this. So you have to factor that in as well. But here she is. So now do our little simulation. So I'm not going to actually scan this in this large space on account of this actually does a flashing light. So it's photogrammy, but it's also structured light together. So, I'm going to pretend to do what it's doing on the screen. All right, so if I were doing this, it would be, you know, something like this, and I'd be shining light at this, right? And it just captures it as I go along. So in little bits and pieces. So you have to spray paint yourself with lights. You have to keep turning the machine so that it catches all of the different areas. So under here, you know, to get up on the side, all the way around to get it. So the whole process from starting to a developed image, including the processing, is about 15 minutes. So
does it know when you've got kind of 100% of the body shape, or do you just kind of make sure you see it finished?
It looks kind of fragmented like this on the screen, but you can tell after time when you've missed something or got something. If it's something that's static, like a thing, especially that doesn't have any movement to it, then you can look at the image and say, oh, I missed that spot, go back. With a person, after they've stood there for 3 minutes, even if they're comfortable, they're going to move. And so if you say, hold that, I'm going to look at it, by the time you come back, they've, even if they've just shifted a little, then it just makes the image off. So it's better to do it all in one go. So this is is walking through some of the steps I did, and it's on video, so you can do some editing at this point and take parts off. So if you included the table, you can take the table off. And then it'll go through this model creation. And this program, Artech, has, it does it all for you. You don't have to do it all in steps. So it's going to do a global registration, outlier removal, fusion, all of these different tech words. The fusion is small object filter. And then it does that all behind the scenes, and then eventually will show us. So then it adds the texture back on as the last step. So there are still holes in the mesh, especially in this because it was catching clothing is actually really hard because there's the ups and the downs. Because it's looking for a three-dimensional, so if it only sees one, it wonders what's behind it. If it doesn't know, it leaves a hole. So, and then also in this program, there's all different ways of editing it. Those of you who've done 3D editing and other things, a lot like Mesh Mixer, except fancier. They actually use Mesh Mixer equally as much as this program, as we know it. And by we, I mean Sarah. knows it. So you can also go back and fill it in. There's a hole in the, where the string is on for. So I'm going to fill that in. And it does it intuitively. There's ways to make it, wrapped, or this is going to make it flat. So it's pretty good as far as the knowing where to curve it or not. But it does treat it like a claymation thing. That's what I got for that. I talked really fast. Does anyone have any questions about any of that? Entrepreneurship, to how I got the business, to some of the technology?
What was the name of that program?
So the software, the hardware and the software is Artech, A-R-T-E-C. The particular one I have is EVA, and I have the EVA, the standard one, so it has a color. EVA Light doesn't. And then my computer is a Sager, which is a gaming computer. So it has the processors and things. It's loud and heavy and fast.
So if we want to buy our own scanner, what would that be?
This system is about $15,000. I got it because the government was giving extremely good loans in the pandemic, so $25,000, 30 years, 3%. I didn't have to start paying, I haven't started paying it back yet, but when I do, it's gonna be like $100 a month. So, yeah,
so not a bad deal. What energy is being emitted from that handheld device? Is it sound waves?
Or it's light. It's light.
So it's reflection that you're looking at?
It's magic. It's like
it's structured. It's drawing lines on the surface and then basically takes photos of it and just like post photos.
So I mean, how does it figure out the distance from the source to the surface of the shirt that you have on
there? I've understood it to be like radar, that it has a measuring thing. You have to be within a certain threshold, and it'll tell you if you're further away, it'll be blue. If you're too close, it turns red. But it's pretty smart. If you lose it, the tracking, it'll come back and get it. And even if you have to start and stop, it can put two separate images together quite quickly.
I guess the form, obviously, you don't have arms or legs. Like, so
right.
Is that limited to the foam manufacturing part, or could you do an extended?
Yeah, that's a really great question. It's possible for us to do arms and legs. It's been difficult to figure out how and why. So because we're using the two-inch foam.
then we have to figure out where to cut it. So there's no less undercutting. But let's just pretend that we had a 5-axis and we just cut the arm. Do we want the arm here for sewing, just to fill it out? Do we want it to move so we can see what it moves like? Because then you got a joint, and then this whole body moves, and then that's orthotics. And then same with the legs. A lot of people, if I were to put a leg on the bottom of this, with that foam, it's going to hang straight down. But maybe my legs aren't straight underneath my legs. Maybe they're, I can only do it with one leg, but if my gravity, center of gravity is in, on my toes or on my heels or sideways, how do I get that? I have to anchor it to the floor, and then do I joint it, and how do you get it in there? And I haven't actually seen anybody sewing with those appendages. So if I can see somebody actually using it, other than just stuffing it out to see what the sleeve looks like, then I'm gonna know how to do this part. But not too many people drape or do their costume construction all together. They're gonna do something fancy for their arms, like the guy who does the armor. He does just his arm. He doesn't do it here, and he's actually made articulated things so that he can, he's really cool. So, yeah.
So how much does it cost to get a form made?
So the retail price is currently $1,975, so just under $2,000. Most of that's labor. Most of it's the CNC routing. But yeah, my margin's pretty small.
When you get bigger, as you do, can you rescan and just slip a piece on top? You know, like if. Can you take your form and add? So I'm thinking of what my mom used to do with her form, and you repad it on the inside and then put your sleeve essentially back over it.
Exactly.
Rather than buying a whole new form, can you create alterations?
So it is meant for one person.
Yes.
So if you were a seamstress that had multiple clients, you'd want one for all the different clients. If it's just for yourself.
It's just for myself. I gained 20 pounds. Mm-hmm. Can you rescan me and say, oh, I need a piece here and piece here?
Yes.
You know?
Most recently, it's been the opposite direction. It's been weight loss.
Oh, interesting.
But it does work both ways. Weight loss is easier because you can just peel this off and shave it with a serrated kitchen knife. It's my tool of choice. I don't use the hot wire, it's too toxic. And I use a rasp, like the ones that have the yellow handles that have the little square wood rasp. Those work the best. But yeah, serrated kitchen knife really is my tool of choice to shape it down. So I'm going to be very personal with you guys. So this one here is me. It's a little bit shorter than I am right now. Pretend she's the same height. And so I lost, from here, I gained about 15 pounds during the pandemic. Mm-hmm. Right? So it's bigger. So when I altered my dress for my nephew's wedding, on the back here, I left it a little bit further out. I need a little more room. And so then, now when I make my New Year's Eve dress, because I had lost from there down 30 from here, right? So it came off here. So I just made that really tight. Because this is bone, that's there. This is bone, that's there. So I'm a little, if it was squishy, I'm a little inside the squish from here. I have 15 more pounds before my doctor will let me get off the statins, so that's my goal. And so when I do that, then I'll take this off, and then I'll stand next to it and do this. Or because I have the advantage of having the technology, I can scan this and scan me, put it on top of each other, and see, it came off here, but not here. And this actually got bigger, but that got smaller, you know. And so you could do it the other way by figuring out where it is.
A second scan will give you a roadmap for altering the form you currently have rather than having to go get a whole new form.
Right, right. If it's significant enough or enough years have passed, we haven't done that in existence long enough to know how many that is. We've been since 2015. I bought the company in 2018. I've had a couple people come and get a second one because something significant has changed.
Yeah.
Their fused shoulder is no longer fused anymore so they can move it. So now they stand like this instead of like this. And so they got a new one. One lady got hers and said, oh my goodness, that's a lot of baby weight on there.
21, she better lose that. And so she did, and she came back to me because she was smaller, and 20 pounds on her made her go from here to here. On me, it didn't really change anything posture-wise, but it really does all depend on the person. But it wasn't something they thought of at the beginning, but now the time has passed, you know, trying to figure out how to answer the needs of those particular clients that want something new without starting from scratch is possible. You just have to figure out how to get it done.
But could you slip a little padding inside your sleeve if you were just like, oh, I'm...
Yeah, it's
and,
not...
You know, that's,
it's not glued up. It's just...
Yeah, you could just kind of do the old school way of taking your...
Yeah, just, you know, like when I was a little bigger, I just put a little batting on there, taped it on, like the ones that we did.
Yeah.
It's easier because it starts with you. It's got your skeletal structure.
Yeah.
Does your customer just get the physical model or do you have a digital model too?
Most customers just want the physical model. That's what they're paying for. Occasionally, lately, people have wanted the digital model. There's more things that you can do with an avatar now, right? So because I haven't focused on getting arms and legs, a lot of these programs want a complete person. And so if I miss your hands and you have to add on a hand, it's probably not going to be your hand. Unless you scan your hand and put your hand on. But people do want the digital image. My clients, of course, are in their foundation garments. So when the sweet lady said, oh, this is so fun, my grandson's just into this sort of thing, I'll just give him my little STL. I'm like, ooh. And she said, well, maybe not. You know, it's her and her. So, but the thought would be another business idea that's all out there with this is trying to figure out how to get, you saw how difficult it was to get that sweatshirt, right? And get a lot of stuff. If I can figure that out, then I can give you, and then you put yourself into the game. Because Epic Games does now have a platform that you can go, a marketplace you can go in and buy special characters to upload into your game. So if I can figure out how to either make a selection of real people to upload or figure out how to get quick and fast to get one person up to upload, then you could have your own self in Fortnite or whatever, I don't know, games. So insert your favorite gaming platform here.
So must you travel to your location for the scan?
Yeah, so right now, because I don't have a network of scanners, I prefer to do my own scans with this machine, or have Sarah do it in DC. So how we do it now is I say, there's a bunch of people in Seattle. Hey, you guys in Seattle, are you ready now? And they'll say yes. And I'll say, okay, I got 10. Okay, I'll come to Seattle. And then I'll put it out and I'll get a few more from someplace else, a few more from someplace else. And hopefully it's enough people to pay for the trip. And then I get out here and someone says, oh, I was gonna come up, but can you come down to Portland? And I'll say, I have an entire free day, yes, drive down to Portland. And then I say, Portland, hey, Portland, I'm coming down to Portland. And then I got three people down there instead of just one. So yeah, so that's kind of how I do it now. In the future, that might have to change. It's a really expensive way to have overhead. So it might be a little more strict about, Are you really sure? but, or I'll pick, you know, in March I'll be in Seattle, in April I'll be in Southern California, in May I'll be in Upper Portland, you know, that kind of thing, and just set a schedule and that's what it is. That makes my heart hurt, because if there's somebody who really wants it that's in Kansas and I'm on a drive down to Texas, I might as well stop in Kansas. It's a little out of the way. I'll figure it out. But hopefully, my dream is that technology like this and people who know things about this, I can teach them my control measurements too, right? Like when I take a neck measurement, it's not the same as a clothing neck measurement. You know, I want to see like what this measurement is. Not this one, it's going to catch that. You know, when I do body and I call it a true waist, well, what does that mean? A definition that's on my paper. So I mean, that person have that same measurement, not what they think true waist is, all of those things. So, because those are the things I use as controls to cut the body.
have those all written down. You just got to train somebody how to do it all. Convince someone to spend $15,000 on a scanner. and by making more connections with groups like yours, organizations like this, it fosters that it might happen quicker because there are people who are interested rather than me just throwing out to the sewing community, hey, who wants to add a scanner to their fabric store? it's been fun.
So do you sell those 3D scanners?
I don't. Our tech is based out of Germany, and they have representatives all over. The guy that sold me mine was actually trying to sell me a different brand, but I knew our tech, so because another person I worked with had used it, so we stuck with this one. But they actually have two systems.
Yeah, what's the timeline?
So
from start to finish.
If someone got their scan today, all the stars aligned. It's about 20 person hours to get it done. But Sarah needs to have time to edit it. And she's also a yoga instructor and fiber artist. And now she's doing glass blowing to do a project before the end of the year because, you know, art. And if she could do it right now, then that would take 2 hours. And then if she could send it to Brian and he's all ready to go, then that takes about 4 hours. And then, you know, so all those things notwithstanding is about 20 person hours, but in reality it's 6 to 8 weeks, sometimes 10. And right now with a holiday in the middle there, I'm gonna try to get years before the holiday, but it might be right after, because I have to drive down to Florida for the holidays. So being a one person shop makes timing very, very challenging. But yeah, 6 to 8 weeks is usually what it is.
So what did you say that originally the technology was used for?
It's used for things, for reverse engineering things. So if you wanted a cat drawing of your chair, so you could replicate it, or if you had a part, when I was in the machine shop, as my shop space, they would bring me parts that had broken on their huge machines, and they'd say, here's a little broken fan, can you scan it? And so I would try to scan it. Then they would have the CAD drawing rather than starting from scratch so they can 3D print it. Architectural drawings. There's different sizes of this technology for either little things or big things. This is sort of a person size thing. So.
Do you envision that changing rapidly, this technology?
Oh yeah, minute by minute.
Yeah.
I don't. That's why I call it the magic, because I'm not entirely sure what it all is. Because I learned one thing and then it all changes. So, but yeah, I think that if you talk to some of the people around here that do this sort of thing more regularly, it's going to be the way. Especially as they develop printing technology, 3D printing. Remember when we thought that was interesting? Remember that? We're like, wait, you're gonna print like a thing? Like really? Like how's that gonna work? Yeah, that's not really, nobody's really good at that. So of course now they do. I met someone at the Artisan Society in Boston who was working on a patent to 3D print in foam. And that just blows my mind because foam is like a chemical reaction between two things, right? And the only reason it stops is because it's got a mold, which is why they come in flat sheets. So how is he gonna 3D print? I didn't ask him to explain it, but he's working on the patent. I haven't heard from him, so I don't know how it's working, but yeah, all that kind of stuff. They're going to be 3D printing. 3D printing is no longer just the coils, right? So who knows what that will look like. People are innovative, so figure it out. Anybody else?
Somebody want to get scanned today? What's the process?
Yeah, so if you want to scan today, if you want to order a DittoForm, that's one thing. So we'll deal with that separately. But if you just want to scan this, you want to scan the thing, it's what I have time for. I have one person scheduled up to order a DittoForm. After that, I'm here until you all close. So we'll be downstairs in the textile space. I can try to scan you with what you're wearing, we can try to scan you how I scan you, and then if you decide to order sold, but if you do want to just experience the technology, I'm happy to show it to you.
Thank you.
All right, anything final before we wrap up? No? All right, thank you everyone for coming, and if anyone does want to get scanned, please just let us know. We have set up some space in the dye lab, which has doors, so you can have a private space if you desperately want a scan. So there is a space set up, and we will figure out an order of operations for everyone who needs a scan.
Yeah, and just to clarify, there is no obligation if they get a scan.
Absolutely. True. So, because they have time to do it, we'll do it. Awesome. So if you just get one, my information is on that paper that's floating around. The little QR code will get you to the link tree. Get you to.
Yeah, I can see it.